You went on a podcast and you said the earth, you believe the earth was flat.
But on that podcast, I was just really like, man, what's going on within our world? And just a whole bunch of truth and conspiracy. I was just like, whoa, this is too much for me. And then I come out and say that. And then, whoo.
I know, flat earth, one of the most controversial theories of all time. And I'm going to be honest, I've never even looked into it because there's such a stigma around.
We're going to talk about the flat earthers.
What is a flat earth society, by the
way? People believe the earth is flat.
Still?
Yeah.
That was a joke about the world being flat, right?
Was it?
B.O.B.
B.O.B.
Rapper B.O.B. blowing up Twitter with his theories on the actual shape of the earth.
Rapper B.O.B., perhaps you know him for hits like Airplanes and Nothing on You. He firmly believes that the earth is flat. He is on a Twitter mission to prove it, and he says he has photographic evidence and that we've been fooled all this time.
I'm gonna have to do something I rarely do. I gotta hit the science panic button.
Science Emergency Defense Program initiated.
All right, listen, B.O.B., once and for all.
So they got at you about the flat earth thing.
Bison is always eye level. Once you go flat, you never go back. Where is the curve?
Of course, in a free society, you can and should think whatever you want. And if you want to think the world is flat, go right ahead.
But I love having discussions because they always say that we don't have no proof the earth is round. I'm like, well, y'all don't really have proof the earth is flat. It's just an opinion, really.
Well, you know, it's true. And also, you know, the first civilization to introduce the globe Earth was the Roman Empire.
Being wrong becomes being harmful to the health, the wealth, and the security of our citizenry.
I'm the type of person, man. I question everything, man. You know, I grew up learning the same curriculum that everybody learned. Mm-hmm. I take a second look.
Is the Earth flat or round? It's round. Okay, now let's see. How do we go about proving that? If you'd like, look at pictures from space, where you see the Earth as a sphere. Those pictures are not fake.
All the pictures that they take of the Earth are composite images, so no images that we see are actually ever a camera from real far away looking at the Earth.
Wait, what do you mean?
They're all composite images, because they can't just get it all in one shot, so they have to go around the Earth and take a bunch of pictures, and then they piece it together.
International Space Station residents only see about 3% of Earth's surface at any one time.
If you zoom in on them, there's cloud formations that repeat several times, which how could that ever really happen? They're just copying and pasting things.
There's a small problem with it because there's a very slight gap in between each orbit. It is photoshopped, but it's has to be.
For centuries, a flat Earth was accepted as certainty, until science and sailboats said otherwise.
Then all of a sudden, when you started looking up on Google and YouTube about the flat Earth, where 6 months ago, a year ago, it was all pretty cool videos that gave you reasons to believe maybe this is a possibility.
Yeah.
But now when you Google it, it's all sketches about how stupid it is, or like, people are so dumb and I can't believe people believe this. So it's almost, how do you stop information from spreading? You discredit all of it by flooding the information highways with the debunking stuff, or you're crazy if you believe this. The government actually has a website called the Flat Earth Society just to spread bad information. Why would the government put out information to debunk something that's clearly insane? You know, because right when you Google it, if all you see is you're crazy if you believe this, why would you want to look further into that? So it doesn't ever let you get to the point of the theory that really has value.
Don't even bring up Flat Earth to somebody until you check out how they are with the space program.
So let's start with the Apollo program. Could NASA have faked the moon landing? What are some of the inconsistencies in the narrative that would lead people to disbelief?
Apollo. In fact, it's a litmus test for us.
The moon landing is one of the most propagandized achievements of any nation. I mean, we just passed the 50th anniversary of the program. However, there are some interesting points of skepticism I have come to as I investigated the topic. Even if you believe we went to the moon, you must agree that if any deceptive practices can be found within the Apollo program, or any programs for that matter, then NASA is not trustworthy. Let's start with Apollo 7. As I was reviewing official footage of the mission, I noticed something I had not heard anyone speak on before. The view of the Earth is incredibly curved. Conspicuously curved. The supposed orbiting height was 140 to 183 miles above Earth. The ISS allegedly orbits at 254 miles up. Let's compare the footage. Things that make you go, One point towards NASA being a bit deceptive. Let's move on to what the astronauts saw in space, because there seems to be some disagreement between them.
When you looked up at the sky, could you actually see the stars and the solar corona in spite of the glare?
We were never able to see stars from the lunar surface or on the daylight side of the moon.
Are stars visible in space? The Apollo astronauts didn't see any.
I don't recall during the period of time that we were photographing the solar corona what stars we could see. I don't remember seeing any.
Just look at how Neil Armstrong reacts to Michael Collins when he, out of hand, answers the question about stars.
I don't remember seeing any.
The entire duration of the moon landing, he was in the spacecraft above, but he doesn't remember seeing any stars.
I don't remember seeing any.
But those on the ISS somehow did.
From Mark Cameron, this is from Mark Cameron.
Whilst in space, have you ever looked away from Earth into the black void?
So you can see the stars.
Oh yeah.
You know, and pretty much all the time you can see the stars.
The sky is a deep black when viewed from the moon, as it is when viewed from cislunar space, the space between the Earth and the moon. The Earth is the only visible object other than the Sun that can be seen.
Space, and you're on the Sun side of the orbit. The sunlight washes out all the starlight, so you can't see any stars, just like here on Earth.
There were none filmed in the spacewalks. Yet we are told by others they are very much visible, even in the light of the Sun.
There's all the stars there, and the cool thing is about it, you can see it during the day.
Yeah, you can, and there's more than stars. You can see planets. You can see moons.
You see the gas Magellan clouds of the Milky Way galaxy.
Yeah, you see the Magellan.
Pretty much all the time you can see the stars.
Then when you look out into deep space away from the sun, it's the darkest black you can imagine.
Which is it? They supposedly transmitted a live signal to the president of the USA through the ionosphere, the Van Allen radiation belt, 240,000 miles of vacuum, to a planet spinning at 1,000 miles per hour. And the signal was somehow clear and undelayed from the moon in 1969.
I'm talking to you by telephone from the Oval Room at the White House. And this certainly has to be the most historic telephone call ever made from the White House.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's a great honor and privilege for us to be here representing not only the United States, but and of peace of all nations.
And thank you very much, and I look forward, all of us look forward, to seeing you on the Hornet on Thursday.
That must have been some pretty impressive technology, and yet we still have issues getting phone reception today. What kind of energy would it take to broadcast a signal that distance? What kind of power did they have on the lunar lander? They must be holding out on us. The telemetry data and even the original recordings were then destroyed because of budget issues.
I haven't seen anything that indicates the telemetry data is even in existence. And as I said, even if we had it, we don't have the machines to play it back.
Unfortunately, I'm afraid I can't really give you much of a clue as to where this data ended up and whether it still exists or not.
Though just in time for the 50th anniversary, a man seems to have found recordings from the Houston broadcast.
For $218, he bought a bunch of surplus government videotapes and made a discovery of his own, billed as the only surviving first-generation recording of the moonwalk. This is the footage on those tapes.
These are the clearest yet released of the moon landings. However, there's a lot of information that was apparently destroyed of the greatest monumental feat of mankind, according to NASA. How convenient that someone found some slightly clearer footage. However, let's talk about the actual recordings on the moon. I'm going to throw out these points in rapid fire because they have been covered by many documentaries exposing the Apollo programs. But this list should help you understand what intrigued so many flat earthers. The lunar lander left no crater after touchdown. A pristine environment after thousands of pounds of thrust was used to set the lander on the surface, except for the boots of the astronauts, who very easily disturbed the moon's surface. When the footage is sped up, the astronauts look as if they're in normal gravity. Look at this astronaut in official footage of a spacewalk. He turns his head in space. Turns his head in a rigid space helmet. It looks like stop motion. Shadows are cast in multiple directions in several photographs, which suggests multiple light sources. Crosshairs on official photographs lie behind the subjects, suggesting photo manipulation. The famous picture of Earth from the lunar surface, when brought into photo editing software, reveals a box around the planet, almost as if it was pasted into the image. The moon rock given to Holland by Neil Armstrong is a fake and was confirmed to be petrified wood. Now, why would they try to pull a quick one like that? Neil Armstrong was recorded purposely faking the curvature of the Earth using a window in the spacecraft by filming from the back of the module through a circular window and blocking out interior light, the dark of space wrapped around being simulated.
Very good. Well, we shut out the sun coming in some of the other windows into the spacecraft, so it's looking through the number one window, and there isn't any reflected light.
We only have one window that has a view of the Earth, and it's filled up with the TV camera.
Why was this necessary? Could they have simply been in the high upper atmosphere? Faking the footage could have been justified because of the arms race between the United States and Russia, but also the enormous amount of tax money that is continually poured into the space program. They were spending roughly $58 million a day, according to inflation, since 1969. The technology they used to get to the moon is destroyed, and they cannot replicate it. Which is why we have not been back to the moon since 1972.
I'd go to the moon in a nanosecond. The problem is we don't have the technology to do that anymore. We used to, but we destroyed that technology, and it's a painful process to build it back again.
No other country has performed a manned mission to the lunar surface. And in nearly 50 years, we never thought to set up a camera pointed from the moon to the Earth, like the ISS footage we can watch on YouTube live.
If it's real, that is.
Which would have been cool.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Why has nobody been to the moon in such a long time?
That's not an 8-year-old's question. That's my question. I want to know, but I think I know. Because we didn't go there. We didn't go there. We didn't go there. And that's the way it happened.
No. This is a secret I've been keeping for almost half a century. On July 20th, 1969, Neil Armstrong and I pulled off humanity's first extraterrestrial prank.
Why don't you just put the end to the record in the argument and put your hand on the Bible, swear to God you walked on the moon.
Mr. Cerebral, yeah. Knowing you, that's probably a fake Bible.
Well, you're talking to the wrong guy. Why don't you talk to the administrator at NASA? We're passengers. We're guys going on a flight.
for it.
I don't hit people, but you're going to be on the deck unless you
get well, I'm heading out. I appreciate it.
And get the hell out of my house.
Well, I take your stuff and get the why don't you quote me and say it's bullshit?
I mean, the shadows interact with. I don't give a damn about all that shit.
You're the one who said you walked on the moon when you didn't. Calling the kettle black, if I ever thought of it. Saying
will
I
you
misrepresented
get
myself.
Away from me.
You're a coward and a liar and a thief.
Me to knock you in the head.
Well, I want you to swear to God on the Bible that you walked on the moon.
Okay.
If you walked on the moon, we're given the opportunity to swear to God that you walked on the moon.
I'm going to give you the opportunity to get the hell knocked out of you if you don't leave me alone.
And it's not just the Apollo program, because once you can do the Apollo program, in fact, I ran into somebody a couple of years ago and I loved it. He was on air and he goes, well, just because the Apollo is fake doesn't mean like the ISS is.
The plan that NASA has is to build a rocket called SLS, which is a heavy lift rocket. It's something that is much bigger than what we have today, and it will be able to launch the Orion capsule with humans on board, as well as landers or other components to destinations beyond Earth orbit. Right now, we only can fly in Earth orbit. That's the farthest that we can go.
Only 536 people have ever been to space. That is 0.000067% of the living human population have been high enough to see curvature.
Of those, only 24 people have ever been beyond low Earth orbit, supposedly.
And this new system that we're building is going to allow us to go beyond and hopefully take humans into the solar system to explore. So the moon, Mars, asteroids, there's a lot of destinations that we could go to, and we're building these building block components in order to allow us to do that eventually.
The technologies that we're testing out on space station are definitely helping us with our goals of going beyond low Earth orbit. So we have a really robust exploration program.
If only 536 people have been to space and seen the curvature with their own eyes, then are these relatively few individuals trustworthy? We're going to review some footage of the 0.000067 people who are the only humans to witness curvature with their own eyes. And this is a fact. Anyone else would have had to reference the imagery and video produced by these people and their agencies. The issue is recordings like this one, where this astronaut's hair seems permed.
See the hair?
Why isn't it flowing all over the place in the absence of gravity? Or this moment here, where a cable is grabbed to stabilize a spinning astronaut. It almost looked invisible. Your eyes aren't fooling you, even though they wanted them to. Look closely. This guy's shirt displays a point caught on what could be a wire. Look closely. Guy in background looks like he is wearing a harness. Augmented reality is also a supposed deception on the ISS. This guy is literally grabbing nothing and putting it away. That guy in the background is in front of a blue screen in what looks like a set to fake space footage. Looks like this same astronaut on the ISS playing with water. Weird. Look at the same objects around him, but different backgrounds. Metal pole and wire here, and a metal pole and wire here. This astronaut is playing with something out of a video game.
So what about astronauts?
The space shots are actually shot in a swimming pool, and they are shot in a place that's called the NASA Neutral Buoyancy Lab.
NASA's Neutral Buoyancy Lab has a mock-up of the ISS in a swimming pool that some suggest is used to film spacewalks.
I was told my tax dollars were going to murdering monkeys in space. And now you're telling me they're just faking it in a jacuzzi?
Bubble. Bubble. Bubble.
Bubble.
Bubbles. Bubble. 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 Bubbles.
This is from Joshua Nowicki. And what you're seeing here is a mirage. We typically would not be able to see this from the Lake Michigan shore. We talked about this last night. Conditions are right on the lake that we're actually seeing a mirage of the Chicago skyline. Very interesting. Here's what's happening. This is a good example of a superior mirage. So Joshua was on the Lake Michigan shore. He was looking towards the west, and Chicago's beyond the horizon. Should not be able to see it. However, with the right conditions, we have an inversion. We have cold air near the cold lake water and some relatively warmer air above it. This will bend the image of that skyline back towards the viewer. And so typically we would not be able to see this. This image would be viewable from much, much higher in the sky up in space. But instead, we're able to see it on the Lake Michigan shore.
The official math given for the Earth's curvature is 8 inches per mile squared. And when people can zoom in on objects that are supposedly hundreds or thousands of feet below the curve, this creates some major questions. Thousands of recordings began surfacing online as people began to bring back ships and other objects from over the horizon. Using special cameras like the Nikon Coolpix P1000, rigging them to view in infrared, which cut through atmospheric distortions and allowed people to see even further than science would have us to believe is possible.
We do have a rare view of Milwaukee for you. It comes from the other side of Lake Michigan. Now check out this picture. It's of the city lights that were taken last Thursday night in Muskegon, Michigan, some 70 miles away from Milwaukee. So why does Milwaukee look so close? Well, scientists have a name for it, but it's best explained as simply a mirage.
13,458 was the elevation for the distant mountain range. And from this other place right here, which is at 2820, and just to confirm, yep, 9251 and change, so 9252, let's just say, round it up. That's the altitude of the photographer. So we go to, let's just go ahead and copy that. Go to the Earth curve calculator here. Everybody likes to use height of the observer, 9251.969. And the distance at 440 kilometers away. Let's do this as kilometers and miles. 273.403. So what is supposed to be hidden according to this? The horizon is at 117.799969 miles away, according to this. If you're here, this is at that altitude, your horizon is going to be at 117.8 miles away. And the target over here should be 16,140.1805 below your ability to see it. So let's do something else here. We'll use a little calculator here and see what the difference is. 16,140.1805. Subtract the height of the mountain, which was again 13,458.005. So if I'm understanding this correctly, then the top of that mountain range should be 2,682.1755 feet below the curvature. In other words, about a half mile below the ability of the observer to see it.
In an age of digital manipulation, it became important for me to witness the curvature with my own eyes. Science is observable, repeatable, and testable, right? Unfortunately, I still have yet to see the curvature with my own eyes, perhaps because of my own visual limitation or lack of altitude. What about from planes or from a higher elevation? Growing up, I had flown numerous times from Asia to the USA, and I remember staring out the window on those long, cramped flights. The horizon always seemed to be at eye level, never sloping away. As I investigated, I realized that outside of footage from government agencies and people directly involved in those operations like astronauts, it's pretty hard to find somebody who's seen the curvature with their own eyes. What we do see is video distorted with something called a fisheye lens, which makes the horizon wildly fluctuate between concave and convex. High-altitude balloon footage without such lenses began to reveal that at heights of 120,000 feet plus, no curvature was visible.
Crazy, crazy, crazy high.
There we are. Shh. Ladies and gentlemen, 70,000 feet.
Felix Baumgartner was 50,000 feet higher than you were.
Felix Baumgartner is going to get his heart broken over the curvature of the Earth.
Oh, how I can't wait to see the curve. Couldn't see it from mountains. Couldn't see it from plains. Now at 128,100 feet, this balloon ride will give me what I want. What? It's flat?
Houston, cut to outer fisheye lens camera ASAP.
I've been catfished. False advertising.
Curvature relationship expert Neil deGrasse Tyson comments on the relationship.
With a really wide angle lens, which curves horizontal lines. So in the photo, you see this curvature of Earth's surface. Wow, he's in space. Look at that. No, he's not. At that height, you don't see the curvature of the Earth.
This next point I found extremely interesting. Official documentation claiming the Earth is flat and that mathematical equations used in aeronautics assume a flat non-rotating Earth. Check these out. This is a CIA document sourced from the Russians, and it's titled Dissertations Defended in the Scientific Council of the Institute of Physics of the Earth. In the document, it mentions a near sun and a formula that is derived on the assumption of a flat Earth. This United States Army document from the Army Research Laboratory on the propagation of electromagnetic fields over flat Earth mentions transmitters placed on the surface of a flat, idealized Earth. In one of its figures, it also mentions flat Earth. In another Army Research Laboratory document, it depicts a diagram showing a flat Earth, crepuscular rays that we mentioned earlier, and a near and localized sun. Here's another document on projectile flight dynamics, and the equations in the document assume a flat Earth. Here's a NASA document on the derivation and definition of a linear aircraft model. Introduction. This report details the development of the linear model of rigid aircraft of constant mass flying over a flat, non-rotating Earth. NASA document on the SR-71 Blackbird and its top speed of 2,193 miles per hour. Maneuvers depending on a non-turbulent atmosphere and a non-rotating Earth. Federal Aviation Administration document. Equations of motion assuming a flat, non-rotating Earth. Another NASA document. A rigid aircraft flying in a stationary atmosphere over a flat, non-rotating Earth. An aircraft model for the AIAA Controlled Design Challenge. flight dynamics of rigid aircraft flying in a stationary atmosphere over a flat, non-rotating Earth. NASA Technical Paper 1285, Flat, Non-Rotating Earth. A NASA Georgia Tech project in conjunction with the U.S. Air Force. A model frequently used is that of a flat, non-rotating Earth. You have to admit that a lot of these flight calculations are based on a flat, non-rotating Earth because they come right out and say it. For agencies that denigrate flat earthers, they sure to use the terminology a lot in their paperwork. Apparently, 66,600 miles per hour. The curvature in 1 mile squared is 0.666 feet. The Earth is on a 66.6 degree tilt. Earth's axis of rotation and its plane of orbit around the Sun is 66.6 degrees. The polar circles, located near the poles of the Earth, are at 66 degrees in the north and south latitudes. No matter how you look at it, the dreaded number 666 is all over the heliocentric globe model.
Hi, my name is Vincent, and today I want to take a look at the mathematical significance of the number of the beast, 666. Now, just for a little bit of background, although most of you probably already know, the number 666 in Christianity refers to the number of the beast, or as we could call the beast, the Antichrist. So in some sense, this is the unholiest of numbers. Now, to analyze the mathematical significance of this number, I want to consider the divine proportion, also known as the golden ratio. And this number we denote by the Greek letter phi equals 1.618033988877. In other videos, I do explore this number in greater detail, but just know that it's a number that pops up all around the universe, and it's one of the most mathematically significant numbers that we have. And its nickname is the divine proportion. So let's see how we could explore this number 666. So using a pocket calculator, you could type the expression sine of 666 degrees plus cosine of 6 times 6 times 6 degrees. And you could punch this entire expression right into your calculator, but to see how it simplifies, just so you could follow along easier, the sine of 666 degrees is negative 0.809016994 37. And also, the cosine of 6 times 6 times 6 degrees, if we simplify this, this is the cosine of 216 degrees. That's the result of multiplying 6 times 6 times 6. And when we evaluate the cosine of 216 degrees, we should get the same thing. We get negative 0.809016994 37. So now when we add these two numbers together, the result will be negative 1.618033987. And now this decimal will continue on for a few more places. It may continue on forever, but I'm pretty sure that this decimal terminates. But the point is, the mathematical significance of the number of the beast, now we can see it. When we use basic trigonometry with the number of the beast, notice how the value of this expression here is the additive inverse of the golden ratio. So if we analyze this a little bit closer, this tells us that an expression here that uses the number of the beast results in the additive inverse of the golden ratio. So that tells us that the number of the beast, in some sense, is the inverse of the holiest number that exists in mathematics. So it's just a really interesting relationship that exists when we use the sine and cosine functions, but using your calculator, we could generate the inverse of the divine proportion using the number of the beast. So, okay, well, this is going to conclude this video on analyzing the mathematical significance of the number of the beast. Thank you all for watching, and I hope that this was enjoyable.